Hello viewers, we are starting off a new series dealing with books and authors from Goa, books and authors primarily in English, that is. And the first guest we have here today is Silviano Barboza, whom I know from a long time back, mostly on the net. He's based in Toronto. Yeah. And his first book, his first and main book is called The Sixth Night. Yes. It's called a novel and it's The Sixth Night.
Yes, it is.
That doesn't tell you much, Silviano. So can you tell us a bit about it?
Sure. Okay, first of all, let me thank CCR TV for having me here today. The novel The Sixth Night, actually in Konkani it is called Sotvi Rat, which means actually your destiny is written on the sixth night of your birth. The goddess of the sixth night comes and writes a book.
This is a tradition, go on,
you know,
belief.
Yeah, go on belief. So my father had written some theater about that one in Aldona way back, and I was reading it and I said that gives me a little inspiration to write. So I used my own experience actually during the Portuguese time, you know, our life in Goa, and then it was after the liberation what happened and all that. So it's all, I put all my experiences in this book, so my own experience sort of, and then formulated the story around that, and that's what it is about. Yeah, my character is Linda, a female, you know. And
her fate is written on the sixth night?
Yes, like everybody else. But then, you know, what I want to say in this book, it's not just enough to say, oh, it was all in my destiny.
Yeah.
But you have to, you know, you have to work hard and fight and get to the top. And that's what exactly she did. Because the way her background was that she was destined to be doing some menial work, but she didn't. She came out, went to school, went to Liceo, and, you know, did all the things. But on the way, she encountered many, you know, difficult steps, but she fought over every one of them. And it was very, very hard life. It's, you know, sometimes you work hard and not necessarily you get the results. In her case, it didn't. And eventually she did.
We were talking a few minutes before the camera started rolling about your days as a youngster growing up in Goa. Though now, of course, you are in Toronto.
Yes.
So can we go back a bit and can you tell us about your days in the boarding in school?
Yes. Well, initially, like I said, I went to the Portuguese Lyceum during the Portuguese time, and then we had to go to Panjim. Like here, it was terrible. Everybody spoke Portuguese and nobody spoke Konkani. You couldn't even get a place to stay, and we had a hard time to get. My father spoke Portuguese, finally got us a place with some people from Damau. So that was still, and then after liberation, actually I was looking, when I felt really alienated when I went to the Liceo Afonso de Albuquerque. This is all white people and then high class people, and then when the people coming from the village, they look at you as if you don't exist. And I said, this is my country, this is my village, my Goa, and I feel alienated. So I had the national, you know, I was nationalist then actually, you know.
Yeah.
So anyway, liberation happened, and of course we had to learn Devanagari, which is very difficult to learn, and it was compulsory in the school. And the first time we went to Garden Angel High School, I failed in Hindi, so you know, didn't get any rank. Later on, I worked hard and passed it, and then I got a first rank in the school. So, but it helped me eventually.
I see.
You know, other people didn't take it so easily, but I did, and I learned Hindi, and that's why it helped me in my writing in Konkani.
We tend to glamorize the good old days, but there was a tough side to it, which we forget also.
Well,
you were in Garden Angel.
In Garden Angel, very, you know, top school in Goa, and top rankers came from there. I myself came 11th in Goa.
Oh.
At that time, got National Merit Scholarship. And after that, went to Chowdhury College, did the BSc, and then went to Bombay, did the management course. And then got a job in Indian Overseas Bank. In Bombay, and was transferred to Panjim. This was 1973. I went to UK, and then from there went all over Germany, Switzerland, hitchhiking 2 years.
Really?
And finally, I got my immigration to Canada in 75. I moved to Toronto.
Wanderlust, that's part of the Goan story. You know, Goans want to migrate all over and do
yes,
all kinds of
yes.
things. But tell us a little bit more about your other cultural productions, because you're not only into the written word,
exactly.
you're into music as well.
Yes, yes.
And this is Classic Goa.
Classic Goa.
I think Lorna
was there. Yeah,
yeah. How did it come about?
I always wanted to write. In fact, you know, I was singing English tunes and stuff like that from Radio Goa, and my brother said, why are you singing, imitating them? Write yourself. write something. So,
in which year?
This was 68, 66 or something like that. You should write. So that's when I was writing poems, actually. I wrote poems in Konkani, and then I sent them to All India Radio, and then I went and recited them. And later on, I wrote some poems for CNN Times, Goa Times in Bombay, and they also published.
These were the magazines which were prominent then.
That's right, yeah.
They gave a great outlet
yes,
to local
exactly.
Expression.
Or Bharat Raja East and another yeah. one. So those are the only ones which were there. So they published and you feel good like that. Yeah. So that was the initial thing. So, and I read Reginald Fernandez, who was a romance in Boropia, Halodo. So. Yeah. And Bharat Raja East also, when I was about 7-8 years old, I started reading that from my uncle. That gives me some inspiration to write. And because my brother, my dad had written a book, I wrote some lyrics and I said I want to make a CD or cassette that time. And then I came to Goa and that was my project. And I did got Lorna and Anthony and
this
Young
was
Chico.
Much later, no? Which year?
This was 1999.
99.
Yes.
Actually
the book came later, 2004.
Yeah.
So every time I came here, I used to do a project like that. So.
But it's strange because when most Goans go abroad or overseas or out of Goa, they tend to forget the language. You didn't.
Yes, no, not me. I am a Konkani lover. So when I went to Toronto, yeah. I was all alone by myself. And I used to, my four walls, I used to speak myself Konkani in myself.
Wow.
I used to just, was looking for someone who spoke Konkani because most of the Goans in Africa, in Toronto yeah. came from Africa and of course they didn't speak in Konkani. And the dances in GOA, Goan versus, they had English songs or, the African songs or whatever, but never Konkani. But later on, Goans from Middle East and Goa came, and then, of course, the theater also started in 75. In fact, it was started by Goans from Africa.
Really?
But their pronunciation was really bad. It was not when you went there.
Different.
For us, for me, but they really work hard. They really work hard. So they did something. So it wasn't that bad, but it was okay. But later on, this is 75 was the first theater in Toronto.
Right.
And later on, 80, some Goans came from Middle East and all. And of course, then it was really good Konkani. And then it was just like here. I mean, there's not too much difference now. The Goans there really perform just like here.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. What's the state of Goan broadcasting music lyrics in Toronto, in Konkani particularly? I was thinking of this radio program called Radio Mango.
Yes.
On which you also were interviewed.
Yes, that's right. Of course, we had actually, you won't believe, there are four albums produced in Canada, mine being one of them. There are three others, they produced them in Toronto. And of course, anything related to Konkani, because there are people like for the theater, we have about 500 plus audience. Yeah, even though there are about more than 20,000 Goans, only 500 people show up, but that itself is good.
Good enough.
And eventually, Radio Mango came, and Milena is the one who produces it. And yeah, Zachary, Milena.
From Para.
She was behind it and she got some Mangalorians, like partnership, Goan and Mangalorean partnership. And they started four years ago. And then, of course, I was there, I volunteered myself to read the news for Goan news and help in the sense that. So it was growing up. And then later on, of course, it was live. And then later on, they went online.
It was on the air and then they went online because
went
the cost
online.
Of broadcasting
yes,
that
yes.
2 hours a week
yes.
is pretty costly
yeah,
or whatever.
Yeah, yeah. So, that way our Konkani is really, really doing very well, and everybody likes it. If I go to a supermarket, if I see one Konkani word, my God, I get so excited, and that's how we meet quite a few people.
So, Silviano, you obviously believe that culture, literature, music is important for the life of any community.
Yes.
Why?
Yeah. Well, in Toronto, we used to have something called caravan when I went to 78. So the people from all over the world, ethnic people from Europe, each country in Europe used to have a caravan, and they used to have a passport, like India used to have Indian passport, Romania, Czechoslovakia, Ireland, all of them. They used to have their own ethnic food.
Yeah.
and different locations in Toronto, and they used to have a passport. So if you buy that pass, you can go to all this, and they have their own natural, you know, local dances and stuff like that. And Goans had some in Dicknies and stuff like that. So, and people, that gives people, you know, a chance to learn about other people. In and Toronto is real multicultural. You know, it's the only place I think all the cultures are being shown in that city.
While it's multicultural, you need to protect your own identity.
Yes, and then you feel comfortable. And because before, when we first went there, it was only Anglo-Saxons, and then they always skip away from you. They don't want you, you know, they call your names and stuff like that. But now, because the Indians are at the top in IT and legal system, doctors and all, so they give you respect. This one, I want to make similar to Goa. Now, Goan people say people from outside has come like that, and Goans have gone there. So they call them names, or they call us names too. So there is no difference. The whole world is the same thing. You have to watch and see something like that.
You know. When you were publishing this book, what were the challenges you faced to get it out?
Yeah, it was,
I remember almost as if it was yesterday, because the launch of the book was at one of our expat meetings in 2006 or 2007 or something.
Yes.
And it was at the Club Basco.
Yes, yes.
And Margaret Mascarenhas was there and
yes,
things like that.
Yes.
And we had a small group of about 20, 30
yes,
people.
Yeah.
And I the photo is somewhere on the net.
I know.
Opposing
yeah.
the book.
Actually, GoaNet was, the, like I said, yeah, GoaNet was the, in
there
the
were
forefront.
Many of these groups. There were
yes.
Many of these groups.
But because of that, we all got together. You know, the guy in Konkani who wrote a book, because he was a GoaNet, he used to write all the proverbs in Konkani.
Dominic,
yeah.
Dominic,
so
he's around, Dominic.
Exactly, yeah. So that gave me also, you know, like, because when I get in touch with other Goans, it's an inspiration. And
yeah.
I wanted to produce it. I know it's going. It's a good book. It's a, it has a story. It has all the information about the Portuguese culture and Indian culture after what happened. So I figured I write a book and keep it for generations, like, you know.
But you came into the scene a little bit before the current boom of, you know,
yes.
easy to publishing.
Yeah,
ones.
Yeah.
Like you came when there was no one there. I think there were very few books. In
yeah,
the
very few. Ben
Anton
was there. So
Ben was
Anton,
there.
Yes. In fact, Ben Anton was there. And the problem was publishing. You know, it was very difficult to get publishers in there. I sent so many, you know, so many places, and they almost got you, but they say, oh, we'll publish, and they give you some sort of hope, but it never came. So I said, I'm not going to wait anymore. I'm going to...
You self-published it.
Yeah, self-published it, but I got it edited through some good editors, and we got it published somehow.
What was the response like? It's a novel, so...
It's a novel, and that's not good. You know, the people don't read or they don't buy, and I'm not a pusher, so they are just sitting there. But on the other side, the CD, it's sold out.
Really?
It's sold out. I made money on that. In fact, with that, I went to Cuba. First time I went to see Cuba, in 50 years, there was like hurricane, like you won't believe. I almost died there.
So, my goodness.
But yes, you know, people like entertainment like this, like commercial entertainment. CDs, they sell, books don't.
It's very interesting what you say, you know, especially because this is the first in our programs, and the point you're making is that we are not great readers. And unlike other regions of India, unlike other states, maybe we don't have this strong reading tradition.
No.
Or it's not being nurtured here or whatever. I don't know how that will change or whether it will change, but it's an important point you make. So you're saying that the book as against a CD was a different experience.
Yeah, not only book, even in Goa for the feast, you people sell chorizo, they make sausages, they make, you know, they sell everything, sold out within 1 hour. My book stays there, not one, three, four copies. So I told them, I'll take a page and sell sausages in them and stuff like that. That would make some sense. But the books, no, in Canada or whatever, they don't sell. So it discourages you. Like, you have some potential to write and bring it for the readers, but the readers just don't.
I'm not so pessimistic, Silviano, if I may say, because, you know, while I agree with you fully, it's difficult to get the book out and to get it to the audience, but it's a niche taste, and, you know, when you reach that audience, and, you know, the problem I see happening is this typical Goa book syndrome, you know, book promotion syndrome, if I can call it that. So when a book is out, no one notices it. When it's out of print, they're all scurrying around to see where can I get a copy of the book, and you can't.
That's very much so. But one case in point, like Francis Rodriguez's book, sold out so well. You know, it's a people like music, like you said, this one. He wrote all the lyrics and the music, put it in music, and it sold out. So it all depends on the people, what they like in it and whatever, right? So I can say, but I'm not happy with the response.
Which books influenced you as a reader? In your younger days?
Reginald Fernandez.
Okay, who may not be aware.
Just for me to go out and try to publish sort of thing. That gives me inspiration, like books. My dad wrote a book, theater script, right? So he had it in Aldona. So he wrote, I said, well, he has done it. Let me also do. And my brother.
He staged a theater and he.
Yeah,
and
he has wrote a book. He published it.
Published.
Yeah.
What was it?
But there's no more copies. Only one is left. And in fact, the TGF Theater. Tag. They wanted me to have a copy. Now I forgot to bring it from Toronto.
You should at least get a digital.
Oh yeah, we will get it there and cyclo style it or Xerox
it. Even digitize it.
Yes, we will do that. So that was an inspiration because he did, and then I came up with it. And of course, my brother, for his PhD, has a book thesis. So
your
we have three books. My brother. Anthony Barboza. Dr. Anthony Barboza, he was a vice principal at the MP College and got a PhD in physics from Bombay University. So he is my inspiration. And
the point you're making is that we also need role models in that.
Yes, sense. You know, that's very much so. And my parents always wanted to, you know, bring out the best in all of us. And that's, that counts a lot.
The Goan parents focused a lot on education.
Yes, exactly. Even
they
now.
They invested a lot, no?
Even now, but in Canada, education is not the one. It's the balanced view is more important. You go out to volunteer, a charity, speaking out, you know, all those things count. But before our parents, only science, BSc, that's it. And there's nothing here, BSc in chemistry, science, and BA. That's the only thing. Now there's so many things people are, you know, do physiotherapies and so many things. So. It's good.
So do you belong to that generation who avidly read Reginald Fernandez?
No, not so much. I'm not an avid reader so much because I was, my parents would say, only study, don't do anything, not even like Uklaba, they say, don't do anything. I never learned to do anything other than studying. But in Canada, the little kids, they start doing plumbing and all those things. I could never do that, but that's what is required. That's a new sort of education. People should get balanced, be independent. And when I went to Toronto, I didn't know how to cook. I didn't know how to make coffee. I just put water and then put tea or something right away. It has to be boiled. So later on, I made some chicken with my friend. The guy threw it out. It was terrible. But now I make sausages. I made the best food ever. I just learned it. I started to do the, see the taste in it, right? Reverse engineering, just a taste, and it has vinegar, it has pepper, and that's why I tried trial error method. Then I finally perfect, and then I of course showed to it my wife, and she's the best cook there. There is, and she also takes part in theater and all. So what happens? I write, but she acts as a comedian in Toronto, and she's known everywhere. So if you go to her dance, everybody say, hi, Sarah, and they don't even look at me. So the books don't mean anything. There are a few people who read, they say, but most of the people, they know her. So, in today's world, the people like and appreciate.
Ours is also the spoken medium, perhaps, no?
Yes. It is. Like, I mean, before here, theatrist means, what theater, we say. But now, it's a fabric, social fabric, and it has to be, all these things should be represented in the whole world. Spectrum is essential.
And we should not lose it while we go into new things, we should not lose
exactly.
it.
Exactly, and especially in Canada, the Goan culture is very much high. They do the roast. They do Bigranjani, even not so much.
No,
and Sarpatel everywhere. I go in Toronto, in Goa, I don't see Sarpatel any function, but there they make their own. I don't know, because the recipes are all available and on the websites and stuff like that, right? On video and also everybody is cooking there.
Yeah.
And here they used to have servants, and now no more servants. So everybody cooks, which is, I like that. That sort of life. Everybody does it their own, you know, no servants or something, and you know, that's very good.
What's your advice to the author or the intending author?
I would say, like I said, I'm biased about the culture, right? And especially the culture before liberation and stuff like that, that's gone completely. I think if we keep that here, it would be okay. But today, to write a story, while people talk about politics in the mantris and MLAs and things like that, and smuggling, all those kinds of things. So it's not very interesting. What else could you see, you know, write? But the fabric, you know, the life here about everybody, I think that would constitute a good story. Yeah.
Going in for a novel is quite a tough job first, no? Tried your hand at short stories?
Oh, yeah. I don't know how it worked out. Okay. What I say, I write the background, you know, small little. When I go on the TTC trains, it's about 1 hour. I used to jot down some notes, something I remember in my childhood, I write down, and put them in a jar. And then at the end of a month, I put it in the computer. And like that, for after 2-3 years, I put it all together. And then I had this precious story. I just put it in the story, and it just worked out.
Very interesting. So, but when you put it together, did it take time to come out, or did it
pop
into your mind straight away?
No, once I wrote it, I sent it to my friends, like Benantow and all the other writers, you know, to get their
feedback.
But there was not much. They said, oh, it's very good, very good. And nobody did. Even the editor didn't have to take out too much editing there. I was surprised. But it was okay, I guess, because it took me about 10 years to write this. It's not just 1 hour. So that's why I, you know, edited myself. And because I had sent to some publishers in Canada, it had to be well edited and properly done. And I also took a course in novel writing in George Brown College in Toronto. So that gave me so many.
You had your experience, and you had
That helped me just to put together, to put fixes. So
any last words about your impressions of Goa today? How is changing?
For me, I'm open-minded. So for me, I don't find anything bad. I think it's good, and especially for people like us, seniors who come here, this is a very good place to retire. And what could you get? Early in the morning, you see the cockcrow, you see Padir coming, and then lunchtime you have a Feni and Susegad, sit alive, and nighttime go for Saibin and Ladain or whatever. This life is terrific. You can't get this stress-free life in Toronto. So I think I would say 6 months here, 6 months there. So that would get both worlds.
I read your very interesting post on Facebook where you evaluated your life when you had your big birthday.
Yeah. Usually people, when they die, they write, Lord, I'm coming home and all that. I said, no. I don't see flowers when I die. You will read my story right now and appreciate or whatever.
That's if you that's had a chance to live it again, would you do anything differently and how?
No, I don't think so. Well, I wouldn't go for science, for example. Like if I have good art or something, you know, journalism or anything else, I would consider all those things as a profession, because you need a profession to get food on the table.
Science was for bright kids, so if you were bright, you went there.
Yeah, you went there, yeah. Fortunately, the IT or software helped me, because I'm a software developer. So that helped me get food on the table. So today's kids, I don't know. There's so many things, and it's hard in Goa. It's hard, especially in Catholics. It's really hard, I guess, unless you're the top. You know, if you're top, there's no problem anywhere.
But we have a long way to go in terms of career development.
Like I see.
Vocational education.
Yes.
Finding the right job.
Yes.
The talent is there, but it's not.
You have to have background in that one. And there's so many filmmakers here, you know, Bhattrai, Barreto, and all. See, they're all coming up.
Goans do well when they're outside of Goa.
Yeah, that's true.
They do their best there.
They do their best there. And then there's facilities to do all those things, you know. And I'm glad that I went out, because I always wanted to go out of Goa, because we didn't have anybody, just the uncle. So everybody went. I am here, but this whole globe, universe, you don't have to stay only in Kongoli or somewhere to Margao.
The migration gene is very strong.
Very good.
Like, but look, I wish people would keep their contact with home.
Yes.
And also,
I look at Goans in Karachi and Africa and all over the world. Now, Swindon and London and Houston and Texas and this Portuguese passport, they're all there. What would they do here? Now, they are doing well. They're buying homes there. They are doing.
You know, yeah, different people have different viewpoints in this. I'm so glad that you've given us ending. You've given us an ending on a positive note.
Yes.
And with that, we look forward to more of your writing, more of reading you online, in print, on CDs, wherever.
Hopefully, I'll do. Oh, yeah. The next thing I'm doing, going to do is a Konkani novel.
Wow.
That's what I'm planning to do. In fact, so I have written the novel in English. Now I'll just have to elaborate and write in Konkani. So
all
that's
the very
my
best. And
thank you very much.
Stay in touch.
It was a pleasure.
Yeah, and thanks to
thank
all
you very
our
much
audiences.
For the audience too.
Yeah, and we'll keep watching CCR TV.